Coming up, we take a look at the free version of Microsoft Teams available now. And with more people using Teams, we're going to show you updates to extensibility and management, including for developers, how you can now bring your line of business applications into Teams. And for IT, how scripting options in Teams allow you to build teams and channels at scale, as well as other updates in managing the lifecycle of Teams over time that span team owners and IT. I'm joined once again by Dan Stevenson from the Teams engineering team. Welcome.
Hey, thanks, Jeremy. It's great to be back.
So last time we caught up with Anne Michels, who walked us through updates to Teams a year on. If you missed that show, you can check it out here. Now, Teams has been available with Microsoft 365 and Office 365 subscriptions for a while now, but there's a new way to get it, right?
Yeah, that's right. Now we have a free version of Microsoft Teams. The free version is a great way for people to start using Teams, whether they're a small business or a couple coworkers, group of people working together, maybe an association. It's pretty easy to sign up. Let me show you how to do that. So we have a page here where I can compare the differences between Teams free and paid. Let me go ahead and click on the free button right there. And then I'm presented with a pretty easy form where I just put in my email. Let me choose this Gmail address here. And then I answer a few questions here about how I'm going to be using it. And then a few seconds later, presto, I've got my new Teams environment set up for free. Now I've already got one going, so let's hop over there. So you can see here's my Teams free in my probably fictitious sheep farm. Now this is Teams as you know it, right? It's got all the features you would expect. I got Teams and channels, chats, I got all the stickers, I got a picture of my son riding on a sheep, he's the one on top. It's pretty much Teams as you would expect to see it. So when I first came into Teams free, I was actually asked to invite a bunch of people. As you can see, I did that. But there's always room for more. So let me bring you in, Jeremy. And I'm going to use that email address you've used for your garage series. I think it was garageseries@outlook.com. And I'll go ahead and send an invite out to you. And then let's go take a look and see what happens on your side.
Okay, so on my machine, I can see that the mail just came in. I've been invited to join Teams here by the chief himself, Dan Stevenson. So I'm going to go ahead and join Teams. And here you can see the invite from Contoso Sheep Farm. I'll hit accept. This page is loaded. So now I can say I'm going to open it in the web app. And I'm launched straight into Microsoft Teams. I can click next. I can invite people here if I want to, but I'm going to go ahead and close that. And there I can see your team. So I'll go ahead and type, hi, everyone, and send.
Very cool, Jeremy. Great to have you here in Teams for free.
So of course we can do text-based chat like we see here, but can we also do things like video chat or screen sharing?
Yeah, it's basically all the core features of Teams. Chat, Teams and channels, files, group video calls, ad hoc meetings, even app integrations. It's all here. And of course our mobile apps work as well for Teams free.
So quite a bit in terms of the free version. So what's actually different than in paid?
Good question. So there are some great things you get when you upgrade to paid Office 365 or Microsoft 365, including more than 300 people in your organization, scheduled meetings, and then depending on your SKU, things like phone number calling and dial-in conferencing. You also get the full power of the Office 365 suite. That's Exchange mailboxes, SharePoint sites, a terabyte of OneDrive storage, and more, including the Office client apps, depending on your SKU. But most importantly, upgrading gives you a full set of powerful IT capabilities, compliance and security controls, and developer options to manage and scale Teams, all as part of Office 365, which I'll walk you through actually in a couple minutes, plus support and guaranteed uptime.
Got it. So in the full version, there's a lot more that you can do with larger organizations, dial-in voice, plus stuff for IT admins and developers. So speaking of developers, what are some of the latest updates there?
We made a bunch of improvements for LOB and overall app developers. Plus, we're working on integrating the SharePoint app platform into Teams.
And this is really great news if you're a SharePoint developer because the custom apps that you're building now will just work in Teams.
Yeah, that's exactly the plan. SharePoint has this rich WebPart framework for building LOB apps. And when we're done, you'll be able to deploy those apps directly into Teams. On the IT side, we've got updates to PowerShell and Graph APIs for provisioning Teams, channels, and apps from business processes. Plus, we made improvements to managing team lifecycle and updates to the Skype and Teams integrated admin experience. Finally, as you know, compliance and security have been important to us from the get-go, and we recently did more work there for GDPR.
Great, so can we see all these updates then in action?
Yeah, absolutely. So here I am in the store, and you can see some new apps there as well as some familiar faces. One of the things we did was we also made it possible for apps to project a personal view into Teams. So for example, in Planner, I've got tasks across lots of different teams. Now with the personal app for Planner, I can see how late I am on all my tasks together in One UI.
It's always good.
Now, if I go here to the LOB app category, you can see a bunch of line of business apps that developers at my company have created for my employees to use in Teams. I've got one for expense reports, a really nice one for hiring and interviewing, one from a partner called Intimate that is a help desk for Office 365, and this new employee orientation or Neo app that I built myself. So let me talk about how easy it is to build apps, and then we'll take a deeper look into that app itself. So let's take a look at the Teams App Studio, which is a super helpful tool for building the app manifest and previewing code and things like that within Teams. Here I've got a card editor that lets me see how some of my adaptive cards in JSON might look. I've got a control library where I can see some of the helpful JavaScript controls that I can use to build rich UI inside of Teams. And then once I'm done working in here, I can export the config for my app and do the actual coding in something like VS Code. Let's actually take a look and see what I did there.
Okay.
And this is the code for the Neo app that is going to provide kind of a Q&A interface to new employees wanting to learn about the company. You can go through here and see a few interesting things. I'm using Lewis, which is the text analyzer, looks at intent, does a lot of natural language processing. It's one of the AI libraries from Microsoft.
Right.
I've got adaptive cards in here, which are a really rich way to show interactive content within a bot response, including actually messages that go back to the bot. And then here's one of those actions, actually, that sends something back to the bot. In this case, it lets an employee attest that they viewed the employee handbook. It's kind of cool.
Okay, so everything's coded up, ready to go. What does that look like then inside of Teams?
Well, let's take a look and see. So here I am chatting with that new employee orientation bot. I asked it, who's my HR contact? Got some helpful info there. I can actually click that button to start a chat. I lost my badge again, so I get this carousel of things that I can do to try and get my badge working. Let's say I want to look up something on, I don't know, the moonlighting policy, given I have a sheep farm, right? Well, I can bring up the employee handbook, and the handbook is presented in an interactive card. I first have to attest to the policies and terms in the handbook, to view the handbook, and then I can open it up, and there it is showing up, my employee handbook. Now, we've got a few other things going on here as well. I've got that Office 365 help desk app from our partner Intimate, can provide some help desk automation for me. And then let's say I'm interviewing some people to join my team because, you know, we are hiring. Well, I've got this talent app now in my interviewing team. I can chat with the bot, and it has a really nice tab where I can keep on top of the interview status for the candidates that we're talking to. And that's just a quick taste of some of the things you can do with LOB apps and Teams. Check out the info below for more docs and code samples, and look for updates on how bots can send files, participate in calls and meetings, and even show their own UI pop-ups.
So a pretty straightforward process to build code and some really powerful capabilities then we brought into Teams. But what if I'm not a coder and I want to actually build some of these apps?
Yeah, so we've got you covered there too. What I'm going to show you now is how I connected Microsoft Forms through Microsoft Flow into Teams for a new employee survey and then had a special text analysis AI engine to make sure I was catching any negative employee comments really quickly. So here I've got the form, pretty basic form. I just want to ask employees for their feedback, a few questions there. Now, I've got that connected up to Flow, as you can see here, and I'm taking the responses from the form, piping it through our AI text analytics engine, scoring that based on a sentiment score, and then if the sentiment is negative, it's posting a message straight into the HR channel in Teams, and then regardless, also tabulating all the results and notifying my team that somebody has submitted that form.
Okay.
So let's take a look and see how that actually works.
Yep.
So I think I'll start by filling out a form and maybe expressing some negative sentiment. So I've got that partially filled out here. I decided they misspelled my name on my ID badge. So let me go ahead and submit that. And let's see what happens in Teams. I just got a message saying that a negative sentiment was received on the survey. So that's important. I can even click on that person's name and message right back to them. And I can go to this tab here and just see the tabulation of the survey results over time. We've been doing so-so here, but that's mostly because I've been sending a lot of negative sentiment in.
So in this case, Flow, and you can also use logic apps really to kind of automate the different workflow processes to do what you just did here. But what about other business processes maybe? Can I integrate Teams as part of those to automate some provisioning?
Yeah, absolutely. So let's go to provisioning. We have a really powerful PowerShell commandlet support, and we actually now have some updated Graph APIs as well. Earlier, we had that new employee orientation team. Well, I want to actually create that team programmatically from my directory, right? I shouldn't need to type in everybody's name. So I've got a PowerShell script here. Let me just show you some of the salient parts of that. So it's using Teams and PowerShell to create a team. Down here, it's creating the new team. And then you can see here where it's adding users to that team. And then a little further down is where I'm actually installing that Neo app that we were just showing.
Right.
So anytime somebody is added to a team, to the Neo team, then that app will wake up and start talking to them, mm-hmm. both in the team and a private chat, of course.
Okay.
So I'm going to run it in PowerShell, create the Neo team. It's going to do a little bit of authentication against the graph. Let me make sure I choose the right account here, prove all the permissions we need. I'll just go with the default name. Creates a few channels for me, creates a bunch of users. And I think right at the bottom there, yep, you are one of those new users, new employees. Welcome to the company.
Thank you.
Let's go take a look and see what happened on your side.
Okay, so over on my machine here, I can see that my Teams is fairly blank. There it is, and there I've got in provision. I can see a toast here in the corner. It looks like you've actually added me to the team. I can look into general here. And here I can see conversations with all my teammates. I can chat with Neo there, which is my Neo bot. And I can also do one-on-one chat with Neo. This is great in the case I've got any questions, like who is my HR contact, like you just asked. So very, very cool, and I just provisioned that with PowerShell. All right, so we saw that users can create teams. Business processes can also create teams like we saw there in Flow. And IT admins can create teams like we saw with PowerShell. But stepping back, though, what are we doing in order to manage the life cycle of teams over time?
A few things we have going on here. You probably know it's easy to control who can create a team, although I definitely recommend leaving that relatively open to unblock collaboration. You can still exercise plenty of control as an admin, for example, with naming policies. Let me show you how that works.
Okay.
So here I'm going to actually try and create a team. And in my company, I'm not allowed to call a team payroll or finance.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go to the new Manage Teams UI, click on Create Team. Let's just try it. Let's give our team the name payroll and see what happens. And it's going to come back and tell me, nope, you can't do that. That's not that's a forbidden word. I can also do things like put naming conventions in, like a prefix or a suffix for the team mm-hmm. name as well. Now, once the team is up and running, we've got some usage reports, actually some improvements to those coming in the near future. And we also recommend that companies create team champions or ambassadors who go around and really help their organization get abreast of using teams. Now, all good things do come to an end, and sometimes a team, well, it's time to retire it. I'm pretty excited about a new feature we have called Archive. Let me show you how that works. So I'm in that same team management UI here, and let's look at this HR coordination working group. Hasn't been a lot of activity on that, no members. I'm going to go down and archive that. Now, what that does is it puts the team in kind of a read-only mode. So the content is still there, it's still searchable. I can always restore it later if I want to, but it sort of puts it on the shelf. It doesn't permanently delete it.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking of deleting, sometimes there's just too many teams. People created them, then they left, they moved on.
Right.
We have this new feature called Expiration and Renewal. So an IT admin can set an expiration policy, and then a team owner has to attest that they're still using that team and renew it. Otherwise, it gets deleted, and then 30 days later, it gets permanently deleted.
Right, so they're resetting the clock.
Exactly. So here's actually how you can set those expiration policies. I moved over here to the Azure portal, and you can see here I've just got the ability to choose a certain time frame or 180, 365 days, and then I can apply that to just one group or all of the groups in my company or, in some cases, none.
All right, so we're in the Azure AD portal looking really at the group expiration policies, but I know that we've done a lot of extra admin work in terms of bringing together some of the functionality between Teams and Skype.
Yeah, so this is actually really awesome, bringing Skype and Teams together. I've been in the org for a while, and it's really mm-hmm. great to see this come to fruition. This is the Teams and Skype for Business combined admin center. And you can see here, just as I go down on the left, you can see some of the different capabilities we have, some of the different sections we have for administrators. And then what I've done here on the right is I actually found my user record in the directory. And when I click on my name, you're going to see that I get my call quality history. If I go to activity, in fact, you're going to see the list of calls I've made recently, and I can drill in on device issues, network issues, whatever behind those. If I go back to my account, you can see here I've got a custom meetings policy and a custom messaging policy. Let's look at that meeting policy. So this allows me as an admin to set a custom policy for a group of users. Maybe I want certain people in the company to have the ability to record meetings or screen share and others not. That's really powerful. I can even do the same for messaging policies as well. So we've got other updates on the Skype for Business front rolling out, which will bring us pretty much to parity with Skype for Business Online, adding features like calling and PowerPoint sharing, things like that. We're even going beyond that with things like cloud recording, screen sharing from an iPad, and live camera feed into meeting as content. And then this thing we have called direct routing is a great way to bring an existing SIP trunk into Teams while still keeping your on-premises voice infrastructure. So how do existing Skype for Business customers move to Teams? Well, just like everything else, it's in the admin center. So we go over here and I can look at my migration policies for this user and click on edit and decide that instead of using the org-wide settings, I'm gonna go straight into Teams. Now it's not Teams exclusively. I still have really good interop with Skype for Business, so I can send messages back and forth to those users and make calls and so on. Lots of companies are running these side by side, and quite a few are now moving to Teams only, which is great. And these are just a few of our recent highlights. You can check out our announcements blog at the link shown below to find out more about the Skype to Teams features.
So lots of really great updates. And of course, if you wanted to see some of those features Dan was just talking about, they're on the link shown when we caught up with Anne Michels. So it's really good to see Teams being made available for more people. The extensibility, the management options, it really helps admins and team owners manage their teams over time. But where can people go to learn more?
Yeah, great. So to learn more about the free version of Teams, you can sign up today at the link shown below. And if you're a developer and want to integrate with Teams, check out the Office Dev Center and our great code samples on GitHub. And of course, to plan your migration from Skype to Teams, you can learn more by reviewing our detailed guidance on this link.
So great stuff. Thanks for joining us today, Dan. And also remember to subscribe to Microsoft Mechanics for the latest updates across the company. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.